Good morning and welcome to worship at First Congregational Church of Woodstock. Whoever you are and wherever you find yourself on your life or spiritual journey, we are so grateful and thankful that you have welcomed us into your hearts and into your homes this morning. We are a community who believes that we are called to express the kind of love, joy, and hospitality that we experience through God in Christ. So please know that you are welcomed here. In the spirit of gratitude and thanksgiving, I do invite you now to lift up your voices and let us sing with joy our opening song, Come, Ye Thankful People, Come. Our call to worship this morning is based on Psalm 100. Please join me in the call to worship. Make a joyful noise to God, all the earth. Worship God with gladness. Come into God's presence with singing. God is God. God made us, and we are God's people. Enter into God's presence with thanksgiving and praise. We gather together. Though physically distant, joined by God's Spirit to give thanks to God, for God is good and God's steadfast love endures forever. Let us join in singing and lifting up our voices in joy, thanksgiving, gratitude, and praise as we sing, We Gather Together. We are a people who believe in the power of prayer. Prayer has the power to encourage us and give us strength, to remind us of the things for which we are grateful and thankful, for us to find within our hearts deeper compassion, and for us to be joined together in the spirit of hope as a community. I encourage you, if you're watching us on Facebook Live, to take a moment, if you're comfortable doing so, and share your prayers in the chat. If you've joined us through Zoom this morning, you can also enter your prayers through chat. And if you would like to, at the beginning of our virtual coffee hour that we will be hosting on Zoom following the worship service, there will also be a time for you to share your prayers there as well. Because we're pre-recording the service, we're not able to collect those prayers at this moment, but we will incorporate all of your prayers in our prayer chain that we send out later during the week. If you have a prayer and you would like to, you can also send it to me through email, revkev@firstchurchwoodstock.org. This morning, as we come together in the spirit of prayer, we do lift up all of the individuals who are affected and infected by the COVID virus, all of our loved ones and families who are traveling, everybody who is feeling grief and lamenting loss because they're not able to gather and have the traditional Thanksgiving that we are used to. We lift up all of the healthcare workers and first responders today, everyone who's waiting a diagnosis, whether it's for COVID or for some other kind of disease, all who are experiencing illnesses of the mind, the body, and the spirit. We ask a special prayer for continued healing for Charlie's nephew, Dougie, as well as for Earl Brazil, who is recovering from recent surgery. Let us then lift up in one voice this prayer. It is a prayer that is based on the poem Prayer by Maya Angelou that she wrote in 2005. Father, Mother God, thank you for your presence during the hard and the mean days, for then we have you to lean on. Thank you for your presence during the bright and sunny days, for then we can share that which we have with those who have less. And thank you for your presence during the holy days, for then we are able to celebrate you and our families and our friends. For those who have no voice, we ask you to speak. For those who feel unworthy, we ask you to pour your love out in waterfalls of tenderness. For those who live in pain, we ask you to bathe them in the river of your healing. For those who are lonely, we ask you to keep them company. For those who are depressed, we ask you to shower upon them the light of hope. Dear Creator, you, the borderless sea of substance, we ask you to give to all the world that which we need most, peace. In all your many names, Heavenly Creator, may you hear these prayers. Amen.
Gently. Will you pray with me, please? Gracious God, we do not live by bread alone, but by your word of light, love, and hope. Make us hungry for this heavenly food. Amen. Our first reading this morning is taken from the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 8, verses 14 through 18, from the Message translation. Make sure you don't become so full of yourself and your things that you forget God, your God, the God who delivered you from Egyptian slavery, the God who led you through that huge and fearsome wilderness, those desolate, arid badlands crawling with fiery snakes and scorpions, the God who gave you manna to eat in the wilderness, something your ancestors had never heard of, in order to give you a taste of the hard life, to test you so that you would be prepared to live well in the days ahead of you. If you start thinking to yourselves, I did all this and all by myself, I'm rich, it's all mine. Well, think again. Remember that God, your God, gave you the strength to produce all this wealth so as to confirm the covenant that he promised to your ancestors as it is today.
Our second reading comes from the Gospel of Luke 17:11 through 19. As Jesus made his way towards Jerusalem, he crossed over the border between Samaria and Galilee. Entering a village, 10 men, all lepers, met him. They kept their distance but raised their voices, calling out, Jesus, Master, have mercy on us. Taking a good look at them, he said, Go show yourselves to the priests. They went, and while still on their way, became clean. One of them, when he realized that he was healed, turned around and came back, shouting his gratitude, glorifying God. He kneeled at Jesus' feet, so grateful. He couldn't thank him enough, and he was a Samaritan. Jesus said, Were not 10 healed? Where are the 9? Can none be found to come back and give glory to God except this outsider? Then he said to him, Get up, on your way. Your faith has healed and saved you. May these words comfort, encourage, and challenge us. Thanks be to God.
As we prepare to celebrate Thanksgiving later this week, I want to assure you that no matter what you're feeling, no matter the sense of loss, the grieving for Thanksgiving past, the missed opportunity to gather with friends and family, I want to assure you that we are a people of hope, that next year, prayerfully, or the year after, eventually this virus will pass, that we will be able to gather again. And I know that for so many people within our community, within our country, around the world, for so many people this year, 2020, has been so difficult. As we pause to give thanks, sometimes it feels like what do we have to give thanks for? And yet I want to encourage you to make a moment, to somehow carve out a piece of a joyful memory, the greatest memory that you have of the most fondest, most joyful Thanksgiving that you've ever experienced, and to claim that and to hold on to that and to remember that this difficult, uncertain, challenging time that we are in, that it too will eventually pass. See, I think that is a critical piece of what Thanksgiving is meant to be all about. In order to give thanks, we need to remember. We need to remember who we are and whose we are. We need to remember all of the great and all of the good that God has done, will do, and promises to continue to do within and through our lives. That this is a season. Don't know for how long this season may last, but it is a season that we are living through. That Thanksgiving is the opportunity for us to look back with gratitude and to celebrate all that is good within, around, in, and through our lives. I believe that both Thanksgiving and remembrance are incredible spiritual practices. If we go back and we take a look through the Hebrew scriptures and into the Christian scriptures, through all of the prophets, all the way back to the words that Moses gives to the people of Israel, it has to do with us remembering. Not fondly or nostalgically, just remembering about what had happened in the past, but remembering in a way that informs us in the present and gives us hope for the future. Remember, Moses says to the people of Israel, remember who God is, that it is God who continues to bless you and works in you and works through you. You are a child of the living God. Everything that you have and all that you are the result of who God is and who you are because of who God is and who you are to who this God of love can be. It is for us to remember. Moses says, remember, it was God who freed you after 400 years of slavery. It was God who led you and helped you find a way when you couldn't find a way. It was God who fed you in the desert and in the wilderness. It is God who provided and guided you in order for us to be who it is that God was calling us and is yet calling us to be. You see, this whole idea of remembrance is for us to actually find the courage and the capacity to live through the difficult certain circumstances and the challenges of our life. Remembering and giving thanks and having gratitude are the ways that we actually find the capacity to see beyond the shortness of the difficulties that we face this day, to see the light and the love that lies on the horizon. That's what I think Moses is up to when he tells the people to remember. Remember that it is God who has provided for you and that it is God who will guide you. And when we forget that, those are the times when we trip, stumble, fall, and find ourselves in the deep, dark valley of despair. It is, I also believe, the story that Jesus is trying to tell us about these 10 lepers that he encounters one day. There are these 10, and you know the story. And so Jesus sees them and heals them and then sends them off to the priest so that he might see them. Because at the time, the religious practice was that it was the priest who could declare them clean. And so they're about to head off on their way when one actually already recognizes and sees that God has already guided and provided and healed them along the way. And so he didn't even wait to go to the priest. He turns around and gives thanks to Jesus. When we remember who we are, when we remember, truly remember, think back to the past, find the capacity for grace and gratitude, we are able to locate ourselves in this ongoing stream of life. We are able to ground ourselves when those storms and dark days move in. We are able to find the capacity to see beyond the discomforts, the uncertainties, and the challenges. I'm reminded of the great painting from Norman Rockwell. You may be familiar. It's actually one of his greatest works. It's actually titled "Freedom from Want," and it's the picture of this prototypical the epitome of an American Thanksgiving dinner, and you see that there are people who are gathered around this big formal dining room, people of all different generations and ages. It looks like it's some sort of a family grouping, and they're all smiling, and they're all looking at each other. And the matriarch comes to the table with this oversized stuffed turkey and is about to place it in the middle of that empty space. It is, I think, for many of us, the image of what we think Thanksgiving is about. But I'm reminded that that painting was commissioned in the deepest and some of the darkest days of this nation. It was the early days of World War II, 1941. The president at the time had given a speech and he had talked about the freedoms, four freedoms he had talked about. The freedom of religion, the freedom of speech, the freedom from fear, in the freedom from want. Freedoms that defined who we were and what the sacrifices that we needed to make were all about. And so the War Department actually commissioned Rockwell to paint four paintings, one for each of those freedoms, which eventually the paintings found their way onto the cover of the Saturday Evening Post. But this one is the most famous of them. I am reminded that what nostalgically looks like the epitome of Thanksgiving was created out of memory. A way of helping people understand that in the deepest, darkest place that our nation had experienced in the valley, in the midst of all of the sacrifice, to remember from the past, to give thanks with gratitude in order to find trust in the present and hope for the future. That's what Thanksgiving is all about. That's what grace and gratitude are all about. That's what I think this time that we're experiencing is all about. For us to find in our own way the capacity to claim the good memories. For us to encourage one another and build one another up, that we continue to have hope to see ourselves through this season in this valley place that we feel that we may be wandering in. For us to affirm and assure one another and to comfort one another as we lament the losses of a traditional family gathering. For us to find the courage to have the assurance and the trust that in time, maybe sometime in 2021, we may once again be able to gather and celebrate in the company of friends without fear or masks or anything that keeps us separated or divided. But for now, let us celebrate who we are and who God is. Let us give thanks for the goodness that is in all of creation and around each and every one of us. And let us give thanks that God is here and was there and will be with us in order to guide and to provide today and in the future. May God continue to comfort us, challenge us, and guide us. Happy Thanksgiving. As we gather together and prepare to give out of gratitude and thanksgiving from the many gifts that God has blessed us, we say thank you to everyone who made Christmas on the Hill possible. Everyone who donated something for the silent auction, the volunteers who organized and made the silent auction possible, taking pictures and posting things online, to everyone who worked in the kitchen over the last several weeks, baking cookies and making pies and boning chicken. Thank you, and thank you to everyone who came out to participate, to pick up your pie and do the pre-orders, to gather up the wreaths, and to make this event successful despite all of the challenges of this time through which we are living. The amount of creativity that it took in order to reimagine what this event might be like is a hopeful sign of the power and the passion that you each have for this ministry. And so I can only wait to imagine what it will be like when we can have Christmas on the Hill next year without all of the social distancing and all of the restrictions. I believe that it is going to be bigger and more creative and better than ever. So thank you for making that possible. We are in the midst of trying to reimagine what our ministry looks like in the short term as we start to bring you more virtual worship services because it's getting colder and we're not able to worship outside anymore, as well as we imagine how do we bring spiritually grounded, meaningful worship to our congregants in our greater community. How do we continue to support people right wherever they are on their spiritual or their life journey, despite the physical distances and the need to not meet in the church because of this virus as it continues? One of the things that we're doing is we are forming a digital media and worship technology team, and we are inviting you, if you have an interest or a passion, you don't even have to have the skills, but we're looking for people who will help to stitch together our worship service to use digital media and video editing technology in order to bring together and make meaningful worship services come together, as well as to create videos and other kinds of social media things that we can post. And so if you've got an interest or a passion there, you don't even have to already know how to do it, but just have an interest and a passion, we would like to hear from you. You can send me an email, revkev@firstchurchwoodstock.org, or contact Rick Singh. Let us know if you're interested, or just call the office and let us know if you're curious or want more information about that. We're happy to give you the software and help you to train you on how to actually make this happen. We believe that if we have a team of about 4 or 5 people, then the burden won't be that much for any one person, and we can take turns from week to week to edit and make worship possible. We're also going to be facilitating a series of conversation in conjunction with the trustees and the council. We have agreed that we need to think together about how do we do worship and music in the coming year? How do we provide spiritual growth programming like Bible studies and things to support our families and Sunday school in the coming year? And how might we build community and have fundraisers in creative ways under the assumption that at least for the first half of next year, we are going to still be under the restrictions for social gathering and social distancing. And so we are going to be publishing those dates very, very soon, but we are going to invite people who have a passion or an interest in one or more of those areas to join in the conversation. So please keep an eye on that. We'll have information and share. We'll be posting more information next week. So please consider which of those areas you might have a passion for. We'd love to hear your thoughts and ideas so that we can think about how we have a really powerful ministry as we go into the new year. As always, we thank everyone who's able to give at this time. And so if you are able, and as you are able, we ask that you continue to support this ministry, that we may have the resources possible to bring the good news of God's love, the hope for a brighter tomorrow, into our congregation and beyond that into the community and out into the world. It is who we are and what we're called to do. And so if you're able to give your talents, your time, your prayers, your persistence, we so much appreciate it. Let us know how and where your interests are. And for those who are able to support us and continue to support us from a financial perspective, again, thank you so much, because you make this ministry possible. You can give online if you go to our website. You can mail or drop your offerings and pledges by the church if you're able to do that. One way or another, however you support us, we say thank you for making this ministry vibrant and creating the platform for our future. Let us join together now, and let us sing the doxology. Let us join together in the spirit of prayer as we offer up with gratitude and thanksgiving all of these gifts that we so freely are giving. God of abundance, we give these gifts as our commitment to give back to you and to care for your people. In the spirit of thanksgiving, we join our hearts and hands and voices in gratitude for the wonder of each day, the beauty of your creation, the abundance of our lives. Encourage, inspire, and challenge us to share the great abundance of our lives, our community, and the world, that fear gives way to love, All who feel lonely experience welcome. And all who are suffering find healing, hope, justice, and joy. In all your many names we say, amen. Let us join in our closing song. My friends, however you celebrate Thanksgiving this year, may it be a hopeful, joyful, and safe celebration. Let us go out into the world with hearts filled with joy to bring the good news of God's love to all who need to hear a hopeful message of joy and thanksgiving in these times that we're living. Let us go and be the church. Thanks be to God.